without you, I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never would have made it, never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all, but now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over all you brought me through, I can see that you were the one I held on to, and I never,
never would have made it.
Oh, I never could have made it.
Never could have made it without you.
Hey, I would have lost it all. Oh, but now I see how you were there for me. I never,
never would have made it.
No, I never,
never could have made it without you.
I would have lost my mind a long time ago if it had not been for you. Somebody just need to testify to somebody next to them. Tell them, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over what he brought me through, I realize I made it because I had you to hold on to. Now I'm stronger. Now I'm wiser, I'm better, so much better. I made it. Is there anybody in this house other than me that could declare you made it? Tell your neighbor, never would have made it.
Never would have made it.
Tell them, never could have made it. Oh, I wish I had some help here. I wish I had just two or three people that would just declare it. Never would have made it.
Never could have made it.
Never could have made it.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Sunday School at First Baptist Church of Bay Shore, where our pastor is the Reverend Dr. Darris Dixon Clark. Let us stand for our opening prayer and theme scripture. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, for we know that it is a day that you have made. We rejoice in it, and we praise your holy name. We ask you, dear God, to take charge of the Sunday school lesson. Help us to learn more about your word, to learn more about your will, to recognize just how blessed we are to have your word. I ask, Lord, that you would touch every student here, those that are present in the sanctuary, those that are at home, and those that are on their way. I ask, dear God, that you just move every burden that might beset them, that they might focus on your word this morning. And I stand before you, Lord, as your handmaiden, ready to teach your word. I ask, Lord, that you just empower me, that you have your will and your way in this lesson. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let us recite 2 Timothy 2 and 15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You may be seated. By way of introduction, let me just say that in writing this epistle, the epistle to the Galatians, Paul found that it was necessary to chastise and correct the churches in Galatia. It wasn't just one church, I believe it was at least three. And he talked to them about their treatment of the Gentile believers. Individuals referred to as Judaizers were coming into the churches in Galatia, telling Gentiles that they must first submit to circumcision and to the law of Moses. Paul addresses in Galatians the spiritual bondage that results from attempting to be justified before God by observing the law of circumcision and the law of Moses. The essence of this lesson is that justification or righteousness before God cannot be obtained by any work of humankind. We are saved from the bondage of sin by our faith in Jesus the Christ, and it is through our faith that we obtain grace, which is God's unmerited favor, and that we enjoy the liberty that comes with that favor. We are free indeed in Christ. By way of a little background, if you look in the book of Acts, you will find that Paul in those chapters visited Galatia, and the Galatian church had within it those individuals who were Jewish by birth and those individuals who were Gentiles and had come to accept Jesus Christ. In the 10th chapter of Acts, we see that Cornelius, who was not in Galatia, was the first Gentile believer. And that's significant because he was a Roman centurion. He was stationed in Caesarea. He was a God-fearing man, and he abandoned paganism and began worshiping God. An angel came to him and said that God was pleased with him and would answer his prayers. And you'll find this information in the 10th chapter of Acts. The angel instructs Cornelius to send men to get Peter, who was staying at the house of Simon the Tanner in Joppa. Peter receives a message from God, releasing him and all Christians from the Mosaic dietary restrictions. Jews were confined under the law of Moses to eating only certain foods, and they did not dine with or eat with Gentiles. But God came to Peter and let him know that this would no longer be the case. So Peter received a word from the Lord. Cornelius received a word from the Lord. Peter went to Cornelius's house, taught him the gospel of Jesus Christ, and Cornelius and his whole household were saved. Going on to Acts, the 15th chapter, we see that there was a council in Jerusalem, a conference of the apostles, and the issue at hand, once again, involved Judaizers. There were those individuals who were telling Gentiles that they must be circumcised and they must first follow the law of Moses before they could accept Jesus Christ. The conference was led by Peter as well as James, the Lord's brother. And the issue was decided then, and should have been the final word, that those who were born Gentiles did not have to be circumcised, did not have to follow the law of Moses. They were asked, however, though they were given certain exceptions, they were asked to abstain from that which was sacrificed to idols or from in receiving any blood or anything from an animal that was strangled, and they were to refrain from fornication. And if I'm not mistaken, you'll see this repeated, I believe, in 1 Corinthians when Paul speaks to the Corinthian church. Now, with this information, with this background in mind, it's clear that Paul's epistle to the Galatians admonishing the Judaizers was consistent with the findings of the council at Jerusalem. The aim of today's lesson, to clearly see the contrast drawn between a life under the law and a life under grace. To understand that we are saved by God's grace, not by our works, and to live a life of freedom in the Holy Spirit and to love others. Before we get into reading the scripture, any questions? Can we see the connection between the background that I've given you and the lesson that we're going into? Okay. This is the fifth chapter of Galatians, and this chapter, Paul deals with a number of things in the book of Galatians, but in the fifth chapter, he focuses on liberty, freedom in Christ. And starting at Galatians 5:1, the word says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ is become of no effect unto you, whosoever of you are justified by the law. Ye are fallen from grace. For we, through the Spirit, wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love." Paul wants the Galatian churches to know that Jesus has freed the believer from the bondage of sin. He is telling them to stand fast in the liberty Christ has given them. Stand fast, hold on, don't let go. You've been blessed, don't lose that blessing. Following the law of circumcision and the law of Moses will not make them righteous before God. It will bind them in vain attempts to complete impossible tasks. Keep in mind that at the time that Paul wrote this letter to the Galatians, they did not have available the scriptures that we have. As New Testament Christians, we should also understand that faith without works is dead. However, works alone cannot save us. And if you want to jot it down, you can go to the second chapter of James, verses 14 to 26, James goes into a rather long discussion about the importance of works and the relationship between works and faith. Just doing good stuff is not going to save you. Coming to church every Sunday, bringing all your neighbors with you, I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, that's a good thing, but that's not salvation. Let me start with 2 Corinthians 5 and 21. It says, "For he has made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Our righteousness comes through accepting Jesus. The righteousness of the Galatian believers came through their acceptance of Jesus, not through the law. And it was impossible to keep the law. First of all, you had the law of Moses, then you had the Pharisees that tacked on a lot of other stuff. So it was impossible. It sort of reminds me, if I might interject a personal thought in here. I remember when I first got baptized, I was maybe about 10, 11 years old, and in my immature mind, I was thinking, all right, I've accepted Jesus, I'm saved, I'm all cleaned up now. Now I gotta stay cleaned up. Well, which for an 11-year-old is rather impossible. And I just got so tired of keeping track of my transgressions. I just gave it up, so to speak. Not that I gave up the Lord, but it was just burdensome. And that's what the law was. The law was burdensome. It was bondage, not liberty. Romans 6 and 18 says, "Being then made free from sin, you become the servants of righteousness." Titus 3 and 4 says, "But after that, the kindness and love of God, our Savior, towards man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior. This being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life." And finally, in Ephesians 2 and 8, actually Titus was chapter 3, verses 4 through 7, and Ephesians, which I'm going to read now, is chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. For God has before ordained that we should walk in them." Just as the Galatians could not be freed from the bondage of sin by the law of circumcision and the law of Moses, we cannot be justified by our works. Paul wanted that to be clear to the churches in Galatia, and the word is here for us today. The benefit that we have is that not only do we have Paul's written word in Galatians, but we have several other scriptures that go with it in other epistles. Questions, comments, thoughts? Something you want to share? Or you just want me to stand here and talk to you? I'll give you a second. Okay, so you're telling me to go on, is that right? Okay. I knew I'd get somebody if I hung in there long enough.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I think that we need, just like the Galatians, Paul and ministers and preachers and evangelists are those persons that God has ordained to tell us and repeat it to us, because there are so many times when we can condemn ourselves. And we can have baggage that we carry. And because of that baggage that we carry, we have a lot of of people who do not repeat this word, this good news that helps us to sustain all the things that we come up against in life. So I think it is important that we say that through the Holy Spirit, we have that liberty and we have that freedom to go forward in Jesus because of what Jesus has done for us, and we are grateful for that.
Thank you, Sister Holmes. Minister Smith.
Good morning, Doc. Point one in the outline, you know, as you said, the Judaizers came behind Paul, said, no, you know what, in order to be saved, you have to first become a Jew. You have to obey the law of Moses, whether it's circumcision. We could play that argument out, whether it's circumcision, whether it's sabbatical, you know, observation, whatever it is. It could be any law. We could apply this same principle. He's saying, look, if the law couldn't save anybody before, why do you have to get Jesus and still also hold on or go back to the law and bring that with you? It didn't serve purpose in the first place. I mean, it didn't save you. Why or do you want to go and do that? As though you're saying Jesus is insufficient. Jesus alone is insufficient. That's wrong. And he has to nip this in the bud now, because you could, again, take this same thought and apply it elsewhere and without jumping ahead in your lesson, you know, a little leaven, you got to be careful. So Paul is, addressing this right here and right now. Look, you received the Holy Spirit. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the law? No, you did not. It's all about grace.
Thank you. And you touched upon an important point, and that is the fact that Paul had to nip it in the bud. Even before that, going back to Acts 15, when the council in Jerusalem met, that was their aim, to nip it in the bud before it got any further. And in Jerusalem, they were not just talking about the churches in Galatia, they were talking about other churches. The Judaizers in Galatia were not the only Judaizers who were out there. So thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Yes, Sister Perry.
Good morning.
It's so good to see you back.
Good morning. Thank you. I don't know if it's on. Can you hear me?
Okay. It's on.
I think the Judaizers, they were so embedded in the law of Moses and all these laws that I think that when Paul came along with Jesus, which Jesus had to come, because like you said, the law could not save you. Okay, but as far as the Jews were concerned, that's their law. So when Jesus came along, or the preaching of Jesus came along, I don't think they really understood it, or they didn't want to understand it. So it's like the Gentiles are coming along trying to come to Christ, and the Jews are trying to tell them, no, that's not the way, it's our way. So it's confusing to them. But the thing is, I just think that the Jews didn't realize that Jesus came for salvation for everyone and for them. But to them, I think it's just like if we're being brought up in set ways, we can't change our ways. That's the way we were brought up. My mother, my father told me this, that, and that's the way it is. So when something new comes along, it's either somehow you can't accept it. So I'm just thinking that the Jews in their minds, that they felt like their law was the law. And if you want to become saved, you have to do it our way, not that way. So it's either they didn't understand or didn't want to understand. So we don't know.
Or both.
Yes.
Beautiful.
Do you think it's tradition? Here we are saying that the Jews are now vacillating because they're not sure. Is it because we're following tradition and we believe that as a Jew, this is, because even today, I think they still believe. So how do you rectify that?
I think a tradition is an extremely important point, because people tend to get bound in tradition. And as you, in your time, you may want to, in your own time, may want to go back. The book of Galatians is the epistle that Paul wrote to the churches in Galatia. It's relatively short. It's only about 6 chapters. And in that, he hits on a number of things. Our lesson today focuses on liberty. But he hits on a number of things. The Jews were reaching back to Abraham. God called Abraham. Called them, being Jewish people, set them aside. And in their thinking, the Judaizers felt, well, look, if you, Jesus was a Jew, if you want to accept Jesus, you've got to become Jewish. And to become Jewish is to become circumcised and to follow the law of Moses. So they didn't get it. They did not understand it. And I think tradition has a large part of it. In the expositor, if you read the Jewish aspect, it talks about how, as a people, modern Jews are extremely benevolent in terms of giving and financing things that benefit humanity, not just other Jews. And part of that stems from the thought that they can be saved and please God by doing what's called mitzvahs, good deeds. And what Paul is hitting on here is that that's not what it's all about. It wasn't about good deeds, good works then, nor is it about good works now. Should you do good things? Should you contribute to needy causes? Yes, but that's not salvation. So good points, I think. Tradition as well as a lack of understanding, and resisting the Holy Spirit. You know, when the Spirit deals with you about something, you have a choice. Either you're going to do what the Spirit is leading you to do, or you're going to do what you want to do. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever really gotten upset with someone? Someone said something to you, and truth be told, you want to tell them off and then some. And it's like the Spirit of God is saying, be still. You, it's not going to be any benefit. But the flesh is saying, tell them just what I think of them. It's a constant thing. And I'll get into that a little further in the lesson. But let me read verses 7 through 12. Ye did run well. Who did hinder you that ye should not obey the truth? This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. I have confidence in you through the Lord that ye will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then is the offense of the cross ceased. I would that they were even cut off, which trouble you. Now, we use in our Sunday school expositor the King James version of the Bible, and I'm not here to support one translation over another translation. I kind of like King James because it's written in Elizabethan English, and Elizabethan English is pretty. It sounds nice. I like Shakespeare. I like Shakespearean plays. However, at times it's difficult to get a clear meaning. So what I did is I looked at the translation from the Message Bible. So bear with me while I read that. I think you're going to get a much clearer picture in this portion of Scripture of what Paul is saying. You were running superbly. Who cut in on you, deflecting you from the true course of obedience? This detour doesn't come from the one who called you into the race in the first place. And please don't toss this off as insignificant. It only takes a minute amount of yeast, you know, to permeate the entire loaf of bread. Deep down, the Master has given me confidence that you will not defect. But the one who is upsetting you, whoever he is, will bear divine judgment. And as for the rumor that I continue to preach the ways of circumcision as I did in those pre-Damascus Road days, that is absurd. Why would I still be persecuted then? If I were preaching that old message, no one would be offended. If I mentioned the cross now and then, it would be so watered down it wouldn't matter one way or the other. Why don't these agitators, obsessive as they are about circumcision, go all the way and castrate themselves? Well, I thought Paul is not just upset, he's pretty ticked off. He is downright angry, and I'm glad I didn't run into him on the day he wrote this epistle. It would not have been a good day for anyone who was preaching the wrong thing. Individuals perverted the gospel and told lies about Paul. Individuals like that exist in the church today. They can lead us in the wrong direction and hinder our Christian walk. One of the things that we're blessed with is that we have all 66 books of the Bible. We also have historical books that we can look to help us. The Galatians didn't have that. But we also have something called the internet. We also have cable. We are bombarded with all types of information. And some of that information is not consistent with the Word of God. Some of it looks pretty. Some of it sounds nice. But if you're not rooted and grounded in the Word of God and listening to the Spirit, you can be led off. As somebody put it, if you're not careful, you can drink the Kool-Aid. And for those of you who may not know, that is a reference to what happened a good number of years ago when a false preacher took people off to Guyana, and they were going to have a new life together. And when things started to fall apart, all these people ended up poisoning themselves and their children. So we look at that and we say, well, that couldn't happen again. Yeah, it could happen again. So it's very important to be rooted and grounded. And in 1 John 4, verses 1 through 6, we see that we are warned about that. John says, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirit, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard, and it should come, and even now is already in the world. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God, and he knoweth God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. So even when this was written, we're being told of the threat to our faith. Come to the mic.
Can you repeat that scripture?
It's 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Everybody that comes on your television set that says, Lord, Lord, everyone who comes on your television set that quotes a scripture from the Bible, they may not be rightly dividing the word of God. So it's extremely important that you understand the word of God and that you study the word of God. Sometimes you're listening to someone and they may sound right, but if your spirit is grieved, then you know that something is not right. So we first look at Paul telling the Galatian church to stand fast in what I've taught you. Stand fast in Jesus. And then be wary of those who threaten that liberty. To be under the law is to be bound, to be tied down. It's an impossible task to keep the law. And to break one law is to break all the law. You either have to do the whole thing or nothing. Whereas in Christ Jesus, we're told to come boldly to the throne of grace that we might receive mercy. We understand that Jesus sits at the right hand of God making intercession. I like to imagine Jesus saying to God, look, that fool down there that did the wrong thing, they're sorry. You know, forgive them, Lord. Because we do foolish things, and we wonder why. I remember one day I was on my way to a funeral, had a carload of missionaries, and I was busting 75 miles an hour in the left lane. And when the police officer stopped me, I was getting ready to explain to him how I was late for a funeral. Now the deceased is not going anywhere. And when I thought about it, I paid that ticket and I just asked God to please help me to lighten my foot, because I can't afford to pay tickets. I mean, that's like reaching in your pocket, taking money, tearing it up and throwing it out the window. But, you know, we do, and I use it as an example, because we do foolish things when we're down here and we're in the flesh. But that doesn't take our salvation away. Whereas if you're going to try and follow the law, there's goodness, so it goes beyond just the law of Moses. There was so much more added on to it. And if you break one, you break them all. So let us look at the proper use of our liberty. We looked at the threat to liberty. We looked at the importance of standing fast in our liberty. Now let's take a look at the proper use of the liberty. And that's in Galatians chapter 5. This is verses 13 through 17. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this: thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if ye bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things ye would. Now, I have a question for you. How would you define the lust of the flesh? What does that mean? Nobody in here ever lusted?
Good morning. I consider it the love of anything above God. The lust, you can lust over anything, your material, your car, your whatever. Mm-hmm. That is considered the lust of the flesh to me. When I see people putting stuff before God, and this is what makes my day. And they don't realize that is going to be here when you're gone. You're not taking nothing. We came in with nothing. We shall leave with nothing. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Sister Perry.
Our bodies, our eyes, what we see. Okay. We're looking at things that we shouldn't be looking at. Mm-hmm. You may be another woman's husband. It may be looking at a car, like she says, or some envy or whatever, but our five senses. So you can have the lust through your eyes. You can have the lust through your ears, things that you listen to. Like when we look at the hip hop, whatever, awards, and you listen to all this crazy music and what have you, or you're listening to gossip, or you just listen to things that you shouldn't be listening to. And you have your mouth. Life and death is is in the tongue of in your mouth, okay? Things that we say to people, like you said, if someone made you very angry, okay? And instead of holding back, you lash out. Mm. You curse them out. I'm gonna admit, when I was younger, I'll curse you out in a minute, okay? But I've learned now to hold my temper, okay? I might kinda look at you kinda funny, but I'll hold my mouth, okay? I'll hold my tongue. So I think the lust is like even touching whatever. It's through our senses and what pleases us or what we want or want to do or to say. So it's in all of us, but as we are in Christ, we try to put a hold on these things. But because we are human, it is within us. So help us, Lord.
Thank you. Sister Edmonds.
Lust of the flesh. To me, that sounds like loving oneself. And we're supposed to love other people. But you love yourself so much that you can't really love other people.
Self-love. To a point, that's not good. We should love ourselves, but not to the exclusion of God and our fellow man. Minister Smith.
So lust is that insatiable desire, perhaps, you know? And it's not just sexual, you know? Mm. I think it's 1 John or in one of the Johannine epistles, you know, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Those are your three basic sins, and that's what the devil uses, because that strategy, that game plan works forever and all time. So that's how he tested and tempted Jesus. It's not just sexual. I could have, my eyes can desire something, and then I will go and pursue that. Whether it is sexual gratification, whether it is my appetite, you know, gluttony. Well, you know, I desire that Snickers bar. I desire that second slab of cake and pie, and I'm going to go and do that. Is it right? You know, too much of anything can be bad. So that I can lust after that. I can desire for it. And if I, as Sister Perry was saying, if I elevate that over my desire for God, it is an idol, and then I run astray. I miss the mark.
Thank you.
I believe that it is also to be contrary to God's will. So we're in Galatians 5, it says, but when you follow your own wrong inclination, your lives will produce these evil results. And it goes on to list many impure thoughts, eagerness for lustful pleasure, idols. And then it goes on to say, feeling that everyone else is wrong except you. To start to criticize and to complain about others. So these are just some of the things that are listed in Galatians. And then it goes on about the Holy Spirit, and I won't read that one.
Thank you so much. That those scriptures that Sister Holmes is referring to are in the latter part of chapter 5 of Galatians. And as you were talking, a couple of things came to mind. The first thing that came to mind was the story of Ahab and Jezebel. Ahab looked over, and I believe he saw a grape vineyard that was owned by someone else, and he decided he wanted it, and he was sitting around moaning and groaning and complaining, and Jezebel said, what's the matter with you? You're the king. You want it, you just take it, which he did. He killed the owner, and he took possession of it. That is lust of the flesh. That is, I see it, I want it. And many times that translates to, I see it, I want it, let's see, I don't really have money, but I got this charge card. I remember when my daughter was young, she was on the phone with a friend of hers, and she wanted this friend to go to the movies with us. And the friend said, well, my mother doesn't have money for me to go to the movies. And my daughter said, oh, that's no problem. My mother has this little plastic card she uses. And I had to explain to her the relationship between that card and the money and how you get the money to spend. You know, that's the not realizing, just wanting and not understanding. Now, she was speaking as a child, but we have adults that still don't have it right. That's why bankruptcy court is still in operation, because we want things that we really can't afford. And we are bombarded in our society with a culture that says, you want it, you can get it. If you can't get it, I can show you how to get in debt to get it. And debt can be such a horrible bondage. It can really make your life miserable. So I thank you for sharing that and elucidating on what the flesh means. And it is, as you have mentioned, it comes from the eyes, it comes from the ears, it comes from the mouth. It comes from flesh, ego, self. I want to be important. Walking in the spirit and fighting the lust of the flesh can be a challenge. In Galatians 5:24 and 25, it says, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the afflictions and lust. And if we live in the spirit, let us walk in the spirit. That is a challenge. If you look at Romans 8:21-25, Paul speaks of the challenge. He says that I find that a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. Our liberty comes from obedience to the Holy Spirit. It is a constant, ongoing struggle in this world to let the Spirit of God have sway in your thoughts and your actions. It's not always easy. I think when you think about the way some people drive and some of the things that come out of their mouth when they're driving. When you think about the pressure that sometimes people put themselves under, or the pressure that this world puts upon people, it is a struggle. But we walk by faith, not by sight, and we trust the Lord. Comments, questions, thoughts?
I guess just a quick point. You know, at the end of it all, Paul says, look, you know, the law can't save you, but if you want to, you know, I will acquiesce in this. If you want to just deal with the law, then it boils down to this, you know, Mosaic law for dummies, or the law footnotes. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. You know, mm-hmm. Fine. Obey the law of Christ. Love God and love neighbor. Mm-hmm. All 600 plus laws can be dumbed down to this, these two points. And when I had helped serve in the AME church, the older congregations that were very conservative, they would recite the Ten Commandments every Sunday. The ones that were more progressive, you know, they would go to the gospel. Look, the law boils down to this, you know, love the Lord your God, and on these two hang all the law and the prophets. It can all be boiled down to these two points. Love God, the vertical relationship, and love neighbor, the horizontal relationship. If you do that, you satisfy all those other laws. Not that you have to do that on top of what Christ has already done. No, but because you obey Christ, then the fruit of that relationship, the Holy Spirit within you produces this fruit that you will love God and love your neighbor.
Sister Perry.
I just want to say that as a Christian, and because we're trying to walk in the Holy Spirit, and when people know that you're a Christian, sometimes they think they can take advantage or walk over you or say things to you, you know, thinking that you're not going to say anything to them. And like I tell my children, I say, well, you know, people may say something to you or act funny towards you, but you can let them know in a nice way, you know, what they're doing, or that you recognize what they're doing, that they shouldn't do it. They shouldn't talk to you a certain way or try to take advantage of you in a certain way. Because as my mother always said, whatever somebody says to you, and if it's not nice and you disagree, you can tell them. It's not what you say, it's how you say it. As long as you're not being derogatory or vulgar or whatever, just talk to them in a nice, quiet voice and let them know how you feel. Because, you know, I'm not going to say who, but someone at BTU one time said that someone said something to her, and she was very offended. And I had said, well, you know, you should have said something to that person. It was like a man. I said, you should have said something to him. You didn't have to be nasty about it, but just let him know that you didn't appreciate what he said. Okay? Because sometimes if you don't correct people, they're just going to dig into you a little harder. So you have to make a stand. Okay? Because you're a Christian doesn't mean you have to be a rug to be walked over. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Go ahead, sister.
A lot of the time when I'm reading these, reading my depository, and I'm trying to go over the weekly word, I go back to the beginning, because the Old Testament brings us here a lot of times, because how many times did in Exodus when the Lord was taking them out of Egypt and giving them better, and how many times did they go back on the Lord, and how many times did Moses have to come and plead for them, and how many times did they lust over food or lust over something and God warned them, don't do this, eat it tonight, and then that's it. What's not there, don't save for tomorrow. Some tried to save for tomorrow. The worms came, and it's like when I go into the New Testament, I revert back to the Old Testament to realize that God, before Jesus, these laws and lustful things has been happening, where God had to forgive them every time because they would want to do it their way. My way is best. And God had to show them, okay, let me let you go, do it your way, and you'll see. And so it just reminds me of today, where we have no dependence on God some, and we want to lust over things that we feel, like you said, oh, this credit card will buy what I want because I want it, I'm going to get it, no matter the cost. I was there, but thank God he has broken me from that bondage. I am no longer in debt. I have not been in debt for many, many years, because God has shown me what I want. If I can afford it, I will get it. If I cannot, it's okay. He has shown me that through him, I can gain what he wants for me to have, because what he wants for me to have is what I will have. So I think that we have to, for me, I take the new, revert back to the Old Testament to get more clarity, which these lessons are helping me a lot.
Thank you. Just to share a thought with you, many times people will say things to us that are offensive or are hurtful. And one of the things that I've learned is that it's very important to pray before we speak. Because sometimes people are speaking out of their own pain, their own ignorance. Sometimes they are reflecting the way in which they were raised and the way in which they were treated. And they bring that into the workplace. Sadly, sometimes they bring it into the church. And so before we respond, we always have to be cautious to look unto the Lord. Someone that I have a tremendous amount of respect for once taught me something. I don't think they realized that they were teaching me when they did it. But I love this phrase: when someone says something that is inappropriate, I think, sometimes I just look at them and say, thank you for sharing that with me. And if their intention is not a good one, it usually just blows all the wind out of them, because they're not going to get a rise out of me. They're not going to get me upset. But we have to be extremely, extremely cautious, because the enemy is always seeking to embarrass, to humiliate, to demean, to steal. He can't steal. The enemy cannot steal our salvation. However, if we allow it to happen, our testimony can be tarnished. So we always have to walk in a cautious manner. And I believe someone mentioned the book of James before I did, or referred to it. And James does talk about the tongue and what the tongue can do. And I know when I was a building principal, one of the things that I used to do, if there was a fight, if I knew who the instigator was, if I knew who the tail carrier was, that person was going to get suspended with the fighters, because it was my feeling that they fueled the fire. And I felt it was important that young people understand that you can't stand in the back and throw stones and not expect that there's going to be a consequence. So, it, you know, the tongue can be a vicious thing. And if we're not careful, you know, our tongues can get us in trouble. I love my sister, but my sister would always say, this is my middle sister by birth. She used to always say, I just can't keep it to myself. And I thought, you're going to have to learn to keep it to yourself. But she would always, you'd always have to tell it all. But that's another story. And I want to just go back to our aims. The fact was to clearly see the contrast between a life under the law and a life under grace. Could somebody summarize that? What is the contrast from this lesson? What do we see?
The law keeps us in bondage, and God gives us liberty.
Thank you.
And in with the Holy Spirit that dwells within us, we have liberty.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, sometimes it's the simplest answer that really hits the target. And the principle was to understand that we are saved by God's not by our own works. You know, can't work your way into heaven. And in terms of an application, God wants us to do what? Our lives should be filled with I know you know the answer. You've said it a number of times in different ways. We're to live a life of we're to live a life of freedom, and that freedom comes from Christ. How are we free?
In Christ.
I'm sorry.
In Christ.
I can't hear you. With
in
the
Christ.
In Christ. We're free in Christ. And we are to do what to each other?
Love.
Now, it doesn't say here to love the unlovable, but there are people that are challenged to love, but God wants us to love them. So many times we have to get on our knees and say, you know, Lord, that person, I know you want me to love this person, but they're so hateful. How am I supposed to do this? God can show you a way, and many times God will show you what that person is going through. Any closing remarks, anything anyone would like to share?
Just to piggyback off of what everyone has said, and I've learned this lesson over many years, that when I get into a confrontation with someone who wants to be combative, like you were saying, Minister Cornigan, we have to pray first. And the Holy Spirit will give us that answer to say. And usually what we should do is give them a soft answer, not a combative, because if you combat with them, you're just going back and forth. It's like a ping pong, it's not gonna be effective. But if you do a soft answer, that usually soothes the situation, and then they're wondering, well, why are they not yelling? Why are they not screaming back at me? So it kind of gives them food for thought.
Thank you so much. Anyone else? Okay, with that, we can close out with prayer. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord in heaven, we thank you so much for all that we've learned today. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your spirit. And dear God, we ask that you would continually have your way in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Oh, I did not bless the offering. I'm sorry. Dear God, we ask that this offering that's being taken up today would be used for the upbuilding of our educational ministry here at First Baptist. We pray, dear God, that you would bless this offering. Bless those that give and bless those that may not have it to give today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I have to make a sign for myself.
Ain't nobody stopping my shine. They try to break me, try to take me out, but I got Jesus on my side. So bad I thought I would die, but ain't no power stronger than the one who came and laid down his life. And I got mountains to climb, but the enemy can't stop me, cause there's a calling. It's always